A game of chess is like a sword fight. You must think first, before you move.
Special technique of shadow boxing.
So I just want to welcome everybody to the Javi Trujillo podcast, dude. And today I have on my fucking, one of my boys, my training partner down at Team Quest, Amr. Dude, I'm like, I don't know. They didn't teach me English right. So when I fucking read sometimes, and I know your name's not English anyways, but how do you say it? Maher?
Like, Maher, yeah.
Maher. Okay, bro.
Yeah.
Amr Maher, dude. Fucking MMA fire, dude. You're a champ in one organization, dude. And which organization is that again? Predator?
That's Predator FC from Philippines.
Hell yeah, dude. So I've known Amr, like, what? I started training at Team Quest last June. And I'd been following you before that anyways, dude. And we kind of chit-chatted online, you know. I think you're a dope-ass fighter, brother. And when we started training together, you were one of my favorite training partners. And
yeah, and, man. Fucking missed you back home, man. We really missed you. After winning the championship, man, I was like, fuck, I wish I was there, you know, but yeah, well, I went back home and I didn't see that happen, but it was fucking brilliant day, so congrats on that.
Oh, thanks, man. I know it was short. I wasn't expecting it to be that short, but, you know, it is what it is, bro, you know.
You know, that's what happened when they go to the ground, man, with you. I was like, I've always known I'm one of the best out of strikers out of my country, you know. Mm-hmm. And when I start rolling with you, and I was like, why the fuck I'm doing MMA, man? Stop putting me in all that weird shit, like the truck and the electric chair and stuff like that. And I was like, fucking, that's strong, man. I shouldn't be treated like that.
Thanks, bro. Thanks, but I can say the same for you, Muay Thai. I remembered one sparring session, man. And I think it was like, I was kind of out of sparring like already for like a month, and I was getting back into it. Maybe it was like 2 or 3 weeks. And I don't know, you were on one, bro, but you fucking like, you pinned me up against the wall. And I was trying to work off of it, and you were just throwing like mad elbows at me and fucking, oh, dude, I was getting fucking shit beat out of me that day. I was like, I'm gonna get you back when we get into wrestling, dog.
Yeah, man. I was like, that was the next session was jiu-jitsu, and yeah. I was like, I wasn't smart enough to count that in, you know. I was like I've never like, I've seen dudes like tap to the twister before, and I was like, what a fucking cunt, like, why don't you take that pain, you know. And you fucking put me into it, and I felt like a rebel, you know. Like, that's, I was like, that is so bad, bro.
Dude, oh man, yeah, bro. I was like, man,
good times.
Good times, dude. Like, I was talking to one of my other training partners, Tommy Hayden, the other day, and I explained to him like what I love about fighting, what I love about MMA, is that regardless of whoever we're, wherever we come from in the world, like, I feel like you can get to know somebody in a 5 minute sparring session. You get to understand somebody's character, where they're from, you know, their family and all that stuff in a 5 minute sparring session than you can have in a 2 hour conversation with somebody, you know?
Yeah.
And yeah, bro, yeah. You a tough motherfucker.
Dude, I was just, yeah, this is one of the things that I've really, really been working on, you know. I've always like, I've been so emotional. You know, I carry a lot of emotion into my sessions. And I think I posted about that in Instagram. You know, I really like put a lot of intensity and anger into the things I do, and I don't understand why. You know, maybe this whatever pandemic and isolation thing was kind of a blessing. When I tell people that, they say that I'm mad, you know, but I was really reflecting on myself as like why I'm just carrying on this aura. And I know I'm intense, you know, and everybody was complaining. You're a fighter, you're an accomplished fighter, you're a champion, you can take it. But there's a lot of people that walking in, you know, that have been telling Dylan, and our head coach is like, this is not going to work. This guy is fucking mad. Does he has a beef with me? And I was like, this is just my way, you know. And
that's the way you fight, man. And like, I think sometimes when people get, like, to me, I like that because I like to match whatever people throw at me. Like I said,
yeah.
I was talking to some people and it's like, all right, bro, we want to get in a gunfight. Let's have a little bit of a shootout, dude. And some people, they don't like that because obviously they're like, all right, I want to worry about my career, this and that. But sometimes you got to be put to the fire. And when you meet another guy who, when they feel they're getting pushed and they want to push back, I always have mad respect for it. So that's why I love fucking training with you. You know, I knew it was like, well, hey, man, if I'm sparring with Amr and we're doing all right, then I know when I get into the fight, I'm going to do all right, you know?
And, yeah, there's one of the things that happened here, you know, when I got to Tiger and people was trying like very, like there are people that really chill. Mm-hmm. Or there are some people that really try to take your head off.
Yeah,
and I was comfortable with that. You know, I'm always been a pressure fighter. I'm never gonna change that about myself. Mm-hmm. But sometimes you have to worry about the team. Like, yeah. if you don't have a fight, why put the intensity up to 100%? That doesn't make sense. You know, just worry about, especially if you have a fight. You know, and maybe you can do that. And I don't know, man. Maybe also like coming from where I come from. You know, we were crazy. We have no background, no education about the sport. So we put on the MMA gloves and we go bashing into somebody.
You're trying to learn it, you know? And yeah. It's funny, dude, because it's funny that you say that. Cause like when I got really into the sport and when I started really fighting, it was about 2008, 2009. And that was like kind of like the end of like that type of era where like the guys right before me, that's all they did because the sport was so still new that it's like, okay, we're just going to basically be a straight MMA fight and we're going to figure this out. And then over that time, we kind of realized like, okay, we got to dial it back a little bit because we're getting hurt a little bit too much or you know, we're just getting injured. And then like, I think because the sport is growing all over the world that I think everybody that figured out, yeah, you just got to go through that because how else are you going to figure out the damn sport? You know, you got to go through that period. And anyways, man, like, you know, what was cool about Team Quest Thailand was like, we have like our morning sessions with the team and then we'd go out and we'd eat and, you know, we all hang out and talking to you, dude. And like your background, like, you know, I'm really interested in like kind of telling everybody like one, you're from Egypt, you know, the sport is brand new there. I would consider you like one of the OGs. Like I know a few of the other guys from Egypt, like two that I've trained with over the years. And like how, like what one man, like I always want to ask everybody who's a fighter on here is like, why did you want to get into fighting, man? Yeah, I know you also had like a career and you had like a family and you decided to leave all that. Like what motivated you to start to take this journey?
Well, I think it's the question is so trivial. You know, you get asked this question a lot. And I think you said, I got to choose to leave that behind, but sometimes the choice wasn't to me, you know, it was, I was just led to that way of life. And I think it started when I was in college and I was doing my, my last year in Germany. And I had a lot of anger back then, you know, I didn't have a good childhood coming from what I come from. My parents are just wasn't there, you know, and, I had a terrible childhood and I always carried that anger, you know, but I didn't know how to channel it,
express it. Yeah.
Without getting in trouble. And I wasn't a bad boy. I was never a bad boy. I wasn't that kind of guy that fucking starts trouble. I was kind of shelled on my own, you know. So when I've seen that kickboxing club in Dusseldorf, I think that's where it all started. That was 2008. Mm-hmm. And I started to learn the sport, and I was like, yeah, fuck yeah, I get to hit the bag. I feel myself like calm down a little bit. And I was like, yeah, maybe this is for me. And when I got back home, I started doing it regularly. And by then I've finished college. I've married my high school sweetheart, which I would not call her that now, but anyway.
I don't think any of us would, dude. I got some girls that I love dearly, but I couldn't even be in the same room with them now. You know what I'm saying?
Man, it is weird. It is weird, this life, man. It is weird. So I got to like juggle both, you know, juggle a career of being a doctor, having a double major and shit.
Wait,
and,
bro, you were a doctor?
Yeah, man, I have a double major. I have a pharmacy and biotechnology degree.
God damn, bro.
Yeah.
I don't think you told me that. I think you just said, yeah, I had a pretty good job. And I was like, oh, yeah, I know that.
Yeah, I don't say. It's just, you know, it's the part of life you're proud of, you know.
Yeah. And
I think a lot of people, you said a lot of people tune in to your channel that are teens, you know, and I think I was kind of pushed into it. I was the kind of guy who wanted my parents to accept me. I wanted them to be there. So I was doing whatever possible to have them in my life. And being that naive, I thought that they knew everything about the world. I didn't question what they told me. So when they tell me, when they told me to be a doctor, I just went in for it, you know, without even wanting it. And I just, you know, life had a way to push me into mixed martial arts. And when I graduated, I juggled both the job and the career, and things weren't going well. You know, I was a national kickboxing champion back home. Nobody could beat me in my division. I was good at it, but, and then I had one or two MMA unsanctioned fights. I got those under my belt as well. And then, bam, this comes the first international fight in 2012. And the guy was a purple belt, Andres De Forno, and he was fighting out of AKA Thailand. And he choked me unconscious. I was like, fuck it, man. I need to learn that jiu-jitsu thingy. Maybe this works, you know. I need to start hugging dudes, you know. So I started a little bit.
I mean, it is hugging. It's a cuddle with a struggle is how I like to explain it to people sometimes. Yeah.
It is, man. It is tough. It is a tough sport. And I'll get to that later. And then I had a couple of fights. And
you also fought on FMD, though, didn't you?
Yeah, that was my second loss in my entire career. That was to Christian Tremaine. That's the guy that changed my whole life. Maybe he doesn't know it. He was fighting out of Team Quest as well. Mm. Like Bruno Carvalho was there in his corner coaching him. And the guy changed my life. He was a brown belt. And things he did to me to the ground, man. Until this day, I can't figure out what this guy did, you know. The guy put me on my ass and I had a nice first round, you know. I was swinging bad. I was catching him good. And then just Bruno, I heard Bruno in the corner, and super aware in the cage. And I saw Bruno, just heard him say, just don't bang with him. Just take him to the ground. And the guy just bear clinched me and took me to the ground, fucking passed my guard like butter. And I think I woke up to the referee just saying, are you okay? That's all I could remember. Back then I was like, fuck it. You know, I need to do this professionally. I need to quit everything and I need to put 100% in the sport. And this is when my life started to really fall back. You know, I lost my wife because of that. And here I am, man, a new chapter, and I moved to Thailand, and
And then what made you want to, because I mean, I would assume it's all the same thing. Like for me, the move to Thailand permanently was because, okay, now, because in the States, it was like, it was just kind of hard to manage a job and a career and then try and commit to this full time. And I had also known too, just from training that, it's like, well, if I really want to take this seriously and I want to take this jump, I need to, this needs to be my life, you know? And so, I mean, I went over not only just because like my striking was shit. I came from a wrestling background and jiu-jitsu background. That's what I did. And for the most of my amateur fights, I just took dudes down, passed their guard and just ground and pounded them, you know? And then if I got lucky, they gave me their back and I choked them out. But I was always terrified on the feet. And one of my coaches, he'd been going back and forth to Chiang Mai, training out of Santai Muay Thai. And he came in one day, he was like kind of the legend of, and he's the guy who got turned me on to 10th Planet too, because he was like the legend in our gym. Like, oh, it's Glenn, bro. It's like Glenn's in town. Like he's gonna come spar with us. And I remembered because I heard all the stories about this dude. I was like so nervous that I went out and just like slugged with him. Like my idea was I was just gonna hit you as hard as you can and get you to the clinch. I slugged and I hit this guy as hard as I could and I fell on his face. Next thing you know, dude, all I see is just flashes of white. Just, and then he just kneed me right in my liver and I just dropped. And as I was dropping, he just kept hitting me. And then
what a guy.
But I mean, it's because I hit him really fucking hard. Like, degree granted, it was because I fucking hit him as hard as I could. And that's when I realized, it's like, dude, I know nothing about striking at all. And next time he went to Thailand, I ended up going to Chiang Mai with him. And at that point, I was like, you know what? I gotta come over here and just dedicate to learning Muay Thai, because like, you know, all I knew at that time was a little bit of boxing, but I knew like, listen, you gotta, I mean, MMA, you use everything. So I got to learn the art of eight limbs, man. Yeah. But yeah, that was when I decided to make the move. And then what made you decide to move over, like full time? Like out of all the places you probably could have picked, you decided on Thailand. Like what was the reasoning?
Well, I think I fought 2015. I fought here. Well, was it 2015? Yeah, 2015. I fought with the same card as Coach Dillon. Mm-hmm. And he was the main event back then, and I was in the undercard. And I've seen all his... Glenn fought on the same card, and Glenn Spav fought on the same card. And one of his dudes as well fought on the same card. Caleb fought on the same card. And I've got to see the team and they all won. And I was like, I want to be part of that, you know. And to be honest, I've seen the gyms in the U.S., but financially it didn't make sense.
Yeah, it's just hard. It's hard.
It's impossible, man. It's impossible for me to make the move. I still have to get a job to get ends meet. No. Yeah. So I was like, I had a passive form of income back home that could provide me with a living in Thailand. I'm good at the stock market and dealing money with shit. And I could survive here without a job and do what I do best, you know? And that Thailand seemed like the best possible option at the moment. And then I got to Team Quest and everything just clicked, you know? I had an awesome year, 2018. I won on four straight fights, got the belt, and then 2019 was kind of a disaster, you know. I broke my leg twice, so I didn't get to compete. And then 2020 was all hugs, like you see now. It's fucking awesome year, man. Awesome year.
Well, and then where are you at now? You said you're in Phuket, right?
Yeah, I'm in Phuket. I got to Tiger to prepare for a fight that was in Perth. That was 4th of March. That didn't happen. And I was like, fuck it. You know, if I get stuck, I'll stuck in the beach. So they decided to close the beach just to make me more miserable. And I was like, fuck it. If I get stuck, you know, at least I get stuck in a place that I've never stayed at before and get to explore and shit like that. And I kind of enjoy it here, man. It's different from Chiang Mai. The vibe is different.
Yeah.
And I got a lot of connections made. And right now I'm actively training. I can't just say where. Yes. I don't want to get the guy in trouble.
Yeah, exactly. You know, super yeah. jealous of you, by the way, dude, because for the last 2 months I've been working like I'm out fucking up. I mean, because I'm Mexican, I got a couple of cousins that have been in the pen sending me some prison style workouts.
How did you find the motivation? That's a big question. Is this, how did you find the motivation to keep working at home?
Me?
Yeah.
Well, there was a period where, like, I guess the last time I got it to train, I got to go do an open mat role at one of the local gyms in the UK. And then right after that, they just – I haven't really blown it up because I fucking lost. But I got to compete in a Polaris trial. So if I would have won that, I would have went to – I think it's in New York where they would have done, like, the big special. And I think I would have been on the undercard with a few other gigantic names in the jiu-jitsu world. But I ended up fucking getting tapped out by a goddamn leg lock, bro. Fucking sometimes you live by the sword, you die by the sword, but it happens. Man. But right after that, they just started closing. And then I just kind of just waited. And I was like, there's been a few nagging injuries that, like, just because, you know, I never really stopped training, that I was like, all right, I'll let it heal. And then I noticed it wasn't stopping. And then it was getting extended. And then the first 2 weeks became a month, and then a month became 2 months. I was out there, and, the motivation came from just being like, you know what, this, it is what it is. I've accepted that this is my fate. I'm stuck in a house when, you know, with a small little yard. And if I am really a professional fighter, if this is my life, I shouldn't need a gym. I shouldn't need training partners. There are ways to get around it. You know, you have to find it through. You know, I think about there's a famous story of this Japanese jiu-jitsu man who was captured by the Chinese and was like, they basically contained him into this like prisoner or POW camp. And they basically made them fight these guys. And he was just like in there working out every day and doing this. And it's like, well, that's the fighter lifestyle. That is the fighter mentality. Wherever I am, wherever I'm caged, I shouldn't stop. Same with guys like Bernard Hopkins. Like, I started reading about all these guys that were fighters who were locked in prison, who were locked in all these things. And it's like, what did they do? All right, bro, I'm going to just get really good at fucking calisthenics and body weights. I'm going to put 100 in the clip every day doing fucking burpees and doing 8 counts. Like my cousin told me, you do 8 counts, keep your wind up from that shit. And just shadow boxing. You know, I just done that BKB fight in January. I got
that was balls, man. That was balls. Really, it's just, I'm a big fan of my face. You know, I'm not going to do that. Yeah, I don't want to get mashed up, you know. I want to get married again. I want to fall in love and shit. I don't want to ruin that.
Hey, man, I'm still handsome as fuck. I don't want to. I'm still handsome as fuck. The only one that really, the only one is that, bro. The only one is that.
I was just telling Shannon, you know, that I would do that maybe late in my career when I got a girl that was stuck with me and she had no other option, you know.
No, man.
But yeah, that was just balls, man.
Hey, and it was, bro. I mean, and then to be fair, I took that thing on. I mean, really, it was a 5-week notice, but I didn't really train because it was like the holidays and stuff, so nobody was open anyways. So I took that on three weeks of the training camp. So I just went around to all the local boxing gyms and just
fucking fought a champion.
Yeah, fought their super heavy middleweight champion for the BKB title, bro. And I was just like, you know what? I haven't taken damage in 3 of my last fights, dude. You know, the last one ended quick. I'm still in shape from the last camp. You know, I still was. And I was like, you know what? An opportunity like this only comes once in a lifetime. And I'm glad I did it because, you know what? And I gave him a good fucking fight, dude. Like, he was like, hey, bro, you came out. Like, I thought I was going to – he's like, I'll be fair. I thought I was going to walk all over you. I thought – he's like, well, fucking fought, man. You know, you lost by a cut.
These guys are good, man. Like,
they're getting better.
People think this, they're just like washed-up fighters. They have the opportunity to do whatever. But there was a guy in Tiger that's called Rico something that is the champion right now.
Oh, Rico, Franco Rico, dude.
Yeah,
that's solid.
oh my days, the guy gave me a hell of a round for my money. And I was like, he was super technical. And I was I thought these guys are just brawlers, but I wasn't educated.
But that's the thing, and why I still want to continue to fight in it is because, like, I mean, that's why I'm waiting to spar, because so what I learned before the fight, I went and trained with a few guys in Birmingham that this is what they do. They're just bare knuckle fighters. They still train conventional boxing, but the philosophy on how you fight is a lot different. Like, dude, you just want to be, it's a lot of footwork, it's a lot of feinting, it's a lot of things to get the guy to bite and then to take an angle. And like I said, like out of all the disciplines, striking is my worst. And that's why I wanted to do it, because like I've been training for 13 years. You know, I did took a couple of amateur Muay Thai fights, but like I was always scared because like that, you know, that's not my area. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna fight a super middleweight champ. I'm gonna train like a motherfucker for this. And I just met all these different guys. I trained with some guys that are like these gypsy motherfuckers that were showing me how they do bare knuckle boxing, explained some tips to me. And I did what I could, but like afterwards, after the fight, I got a lot of respect from everybody. And like, because I wasn't knocked out or dazed, a lot of people said, hey man, if you make a minor adjustments and you do this and that. So I was just like trying to remember everything. And when I was on lockdown, I had an opportunity to just practice on my footwork, practice on my feints, practice on my straight shots. And that's how I looked at it. It's like, well, okay, now you can't do jiu-jitsu. You can't default to the best thing that you want to do. You know, I can't go, it's like, okay, I'm feeling shitty in Muay Thai. You know, all the Muay Thai guys or you guys are kicking my ass. I'm going to just take you down, or I'm just going to go train jiu-jitsu because it makes me feel good because I know I'm good at that. It's like you're forced, bro. You're forced to take the shittiest part of your game, and now you got 2 months to practice it. So that's what I did, bro. I just did prison style workouts and I shadow boxed for about an hour and a half every day. I would break it up, but that's how I do, working on the certain elements that all these people that boxing is their life and English style boxing. And I just took it to heart. I would video me myself and just, you know, analyze myself. And now I'm excited to get back in there to spar and to fucking fight, because now I'm not afraid to stand. If I can't take some motherfucker down, it's like, bro, I got a new style of boxing. You know, my hands are so great now, and then adding on top of my Muay Thai, I'm just excited, man. Like, all of this can do nothing but make you better, and a loss is the greatest investment you can make. And yeah, I learned a lot from that loss. I don't lose often, but when I do, I learn a lot of shit. You know, and that's how I looked at it. And it's fun. I want to do it one more time, bro. One more time. I want to do it.
That's really wise, man. Like what you said is just, the loss is just an investment. That should be a quote, you know. But yeah, for me, it's just a loss. I've learned that. No, you live and learn, you know. And I think the loss is just some people that are so much emotional, like me, for example. Loss devastates me, like gets me in a bad, very bad moods.
Hey man, but same with me. I mean, I know I'm usually a happy-go-lucky guy on the outside, but I'm ultra competitive. You know, I'm hyper competitive, and when I lose, dude, yeah, I feel like I just want to crawl into a hole and die.
yeah, I hear you. It's all the same, man. And you get to add to it that's the best thing that I've learned from this isolation, man. It's just, I've worked with my demons a little bit. You know, there's no escaping you. Yeah. It's just you against you, this isolation. And I've learned I've learned to live in the truth a little bit, you know? Like, I've been busy beating my ass up every day in training just to escape a lot of truth about myself that I don't want to face.
Yeah.
And absolutely, when I faced them, it was horrifying, you know. It's just bad things I know I suck at, you know. I don't have a high emotional IQ. I've learned to shut down my emotions, either my earlier days through drugs or whatever, or I've learned to shut them down by just doing something else. But when you take away everything and it's you against,
you're left with yourself, man. Yeah,
you have to fight back. It's just, for me, when people ask me what is this isolation about, it's just, I always tell them it's a trip to the underworld. You know, for me, it's just, I got into everything that is bad about myself. One of these things is that I'm fucking terrified of losing. Yeah. And not just because I'm afraid to get hurt, but I'm fucking terrified of people not seeing me as good as I know.
Yeah, as the dude. Yeah, as the dude that our ego wants us to perceive. Like, I mean, to be a fighter, you actually have to have a little bit of an ego, because if you don't and you think you suck and you think you're the shit, you've got no business being in there, bro. You know, so it's like a weird balance of like, yeah, I got to have this ego and I have to have this image that I'm Javi fucking Trujillo. I'm the baddest fucking man on the planet. I'm knocking out dudes in less than 5 seconds. I'm choking out cocksuckers in less than a minute. Like, I'm this bad motherfucker. And then the game is, dude, there's levels to it. Sometimes you just meet up with a guy, he just has the answer for your style, and fuck it.
Sometimes you get caught even from a lesser dude that has no business being with you in the first place, but shit happens.
Yeah,
and I to be honest, I've been fucking terrified. Like every fight, when people ask me, it's just, you get scared, and we see you lying there. And I nap before a fight, and everybody that's been in my corner knows that I don't warm up. I don't listen to music. I just nap, you know. And people think I'm all cool and I'm not afraid or shit, but I'm fucking terrified. I'm terrified of losing. I'm terrified of people not seeing me as the baddest guy that came out of Egypt and fucking took the first belt or international belt or wherever. Because I thought all this time that this is what defines me, you know, is being a fighter. But what happens now is that the gyms are closed. You're not a fighter anymore. You're just a normal dude who walks to 7-Eleven to get the shit and to eat, and there's no training. And to be honest, it's just like, yeah, I'm going to live that. That's temporary, man. What we do is temporary. And it's going to finish one day. It cannot define you. You know, what defines you is character. What defines you is walking through challenges like you do, you know. You take this fight here, you take this fight there. You keep challenging yourself, you keep growing.
Yeah.
But if you keep like running away from your fears, you're not going anywhere. And I kind of discovered that about myself. It's just I'm fucking terrified of things that I shouldn't be terrified of.
Yeah, man. And I mean, you know what, like, to get back, like, you said something really important that I thought was great, because I also had that moment too, because I've always used training as my escape from running from a lot of things that I've been avoiding my whole life. You know, I mean, physically, I always, you know, just like, I've never stayed in one place more than, I mean, the longest place I've ever stayed is maybe 2 years, and that was when I was living in Bangkok. Well, 3 years, you know. But outside of that, I always just have to leave. And then, like, and it's because I know I'm running from something. And then, like, when I feel like I change location, then I go to my gym, because that also helps me to run away from these problems. And like you said, there was a moment where it's like, bro, you ain't a fighter. Nobody's training. You know, who are you? Who do you want to see? Who, when you wake up in the morning and you see yourself, who, you know, you're not Javier Trujillo, the fucking fighter. Who, what are you exactly? And what is it that you stand for? And what is it that you've been running from? Because, I mean, I feel as fighters, we all have, either we weren't hugged enough, or we were hugged too much, or we were just lacking something in life. And we're trying to chase that with this art. And we're trying to express all that anger and all those problems and all this stuff in that cage. And for me, the same thing. And you know me, I'm a little bit of like a Eddie Bravo conspiracy type motherfucker, being a 10th planet guy. But I started thinking about like how strange, like, the whole COVID thing started. Like, it started with a bat. Okay, regardless of how people want to say it, some Chinese motherfucker, he ate some bat soup and that's how it started. Or if it was the CCP wanting to get back at Donald Trump for the trade war, and now we release this thing and they're, you know, they're goddamn, the frogs are turning gay and blah, 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 whatever. Mm-hmm. Whatever it started from, and the U.S. Mint, the place that prints off our money, I don't know if you've seen it, but the 2020 quarter now has a bat on it. And that was before this whole COVID thing started.
Dude, this is why you just... for every time you fucking blow my mind with new shit that I don't... and I keep on fucking walking from one, like, rabbit hole to another. And I was just... this is fucking... Oh, my God. This but is look, too much.
Google that shit. Look at it. There's a bat. There's a bat on the 2020 fucking U.S. quarter. And I actually just got, before I got with talking to you, I was finishing up another podcast with this guy. His name is Cesar Nobre. I don't know if you know him. He's actually in Phuket right now, but he's a famous artist and he paints like all these murals all over Bangkok. But he said, I guess he went to school for anthropology and he says that like all human beings that we have, we look at things by symbols, you know, regardless of what it is. And so I was interested once I noticed, it's like, why does this bat keep coming up? This bat, bat, bat. And the bat, I researched, symbolizes in all cultures is a dawning of rebirth. It is the bat is the animal that over time has adapted to see in the darkness. Just like you were saying how you had to look to the darkness in yourself, it brings the darkness to light. And can live in the darkness and brings things to light. And I feel like in ourselves as human beings, because we're all going through this experience together. Look, at you're on the other side of the motherfucking planet. I'm over here in America, but yet we're experiencing the same fucking thing right now. And I feel that everybody's forced to look inside and experience that dark side of them, those things that we've all been running from where we don't want to look at. We have to bring it to light. And I think if we don't bring that to light, we're not going to grow. There's going to be people who grow from this and who are going to strive. And I think you're one of them. And I think I'm going to be one of them. But that's what's going on, is that we are going through a rebirth of ourselves. And I think a rebirth as a human species together, you know, whatever's really going on, if it's all this fucking, you know, we're in the middle of a biological war and China's trying to, you know, tear down these governments so that they can bring in communism, or if it's, you know, Donald Trump just trying to do this so he can enact powers or whatever, or all governments are trying to do this to take over. But I believe the wool and the deceit is being taken from our eyes. And not only are we to look at our world and see the deception that has been going on in the world, but to see the deception that we've been doing to ourselves. And I think that's what's happening right now, you know,
like 100%.
You know, that's what I'm thinking, dog. And
dude, that's a lot of light shit on right now. I fucking love this. This is why I wanted to do that, man. It's just like it's always interesting talking to you. And yeah, that's also the way I see it, man. It's just like it's. I'm not gonna say it's been rainbows and shit, you know, like, nah, I wouldn't choose that any fucking day. But still, you know, the way this happened, I think, like, I've been talking to my mom the other day, and I've told her something that sounds crazy. I was like, I think this has really happened for me, you know. I really needed that, man. It's just there's a lot of stuff that needed to be changed about me, you know.
And I mean to like cut you off, but like, could you expound on like a good example of it, or that you feel like over this time you've kind of had to reflect? Because I know you write, bro. I know you like to write a lot, and I like reading what you write, put in your IG stories. But like, what is something that like you got from this, or you found out about yourself, if you don't mind telling, you know?
No, man, I'm an open book guy. I don't mind. It's just, there's a lot of things. I'll tell you, basically for me, it's just living the truth, you know. I've always carried myself around, you know. I've been the male figure in my family. Mm. I have to be protective of my sister, my mom, and I've always carried that bad boy aura about myself, you know. I can do this, I can do that. I'm not that guy at all. I'm a softie. Just, I have to accept that about myself, man. I don't have to fight it, you know. There's a lot of people that made my life so hard. without mentioning names, you know, that that really like really wanted to change me because of whatever their agenda is or whatever. I rubbed them the wrong way or whatever. They want to see themselves the same way. But there's a lot of people that try to change me, but I decided, fuck him, who cares, you know? Fuck them all, who cares? It's just, it's about me now. And this is what it's all about. This the end of the world, you know? You're just alone. It's, you're by yourself. None of these people are around me now, you know? I'm just by myself. I'm just, I have to face myself every fucking morning and accept me for me, you know? Not just this guy's opinion or this girl's opinion of me, you know? And that's been really tough, you know, living the truth. It's just really tough. Like really putting, it's just one of my friends told me something that fucking blew my mind. It's just being a friend with an unknown. And there's a lot of unknowns in the world, you know? If you think that you know it all, you've reached a level of totalitarian where you're fucking ruined, you know? I'm the best guy of all things, you know? You're not gonna learn shit. And I kind of thought that's the same as having an ego. Mm-hmm. It's just thinking that I'm the shit. Nobody can fucking beat me. I'm strong, I'm blah, blah, blah. But by the end of the day, I'm a fucking human being. I cry. Sometimes I cry myself to sleep. Sometimes I'm having a bad day. Sometimes I'm fucking going back. I want to go back to drugs and I don't want to face reality. And I've learned to accept that vulnerability, man. And I think that made me so much in peace. When you accept your vulnerability, you start to really see the world for what it is, you know? You start appreciating the world. You start appreciating even the people around you that are going through a lot of stuff. You start to be more compassionate, you know? Yeah. I've always played the victim card. It's just like, life is tough. Life have dealt me bad childhood. I've been sick. I've been fighting sickness. I almost fucking died. That's why I don't care about life, blah, blah, blah. I've had a bad marriage. So yeah, fuck life. Who cares? But right now it's just like, nah, I've never been... I've had a bad time, but that doesn't define me as being bad, or I shouldn't come out of that a fucking maniac who want to chop head off, you know? It's just, I want to be in peace with myself more. And that's what I've learned, man. One thing that I really, really want to stress on is it's just, I learned to be more in peace with my, if these are faults to other people, sometimes it is a better thing for other people. I don't know. I don't care, but what I do care about now is just, I'm in a better place and I don't care anymore.
Yeah, man. And if you're happy with yourself, like externally, and you know what? It's funny, bro. Cause it's funny that you're all saying this because dude, I felt exactly the same way because like, I don't know if maybe if it's also culturally, cause I know like, you know, the Middle Eastern guys, y'all kind of like us Mexican motherfuckers, like men don't fucking cry, you know, like, We've been told that we don't cry, we don't hold, you don't talk about feelings, you don't express like where I come from, mainly it's not even customary to smile. Like I was growing up saying, hey bro, just don't smile just for fucking nothing. Why? Because people fuck with you. They think you're weak. And they will come and they'll fuck with you and they'll try and take your shit. Then you know, people will take your shoes from the neighborhood that I grew up in before I moved out to where my mom is at, you know, like that was the thing. And I also had to come to terms with a lot of things and that it was okay to be vulnerable. It's okay to express. I mean, and yeah, man, there were some nights I cried myself, bro, because I just didn't know what was going on. And, you know, me being this conspiracy guy, I was like, all right, I'm going to take in all this information from everybody. I'm going to see what the fuck these fucktards on CNN are saying this. These Fox News people are saying this. You know, fucking Alex Jones and Eddie Bravo and all these guys, they're telling me this. And it's just like, I'm trying to make sense of it all. And at the end of the day, I've realized nobody knows what the fuck is going on. And exactly. I don't know what the fuck is going on. But the only thing that I know is what's inside. And I know that I want to come from a place of good. And I always want to speak truthful because I feel like I'm in a world of deceit. And somebody's got to be honest in me, Yeah.
100%.
Got to be honest.
You know, Nietzsche had that quote that I hope that I remember correctly, is the man's worth is what he knows about himself and what he knows about himself that is true. And I think a lot of things that I've been putting on and showing off, it's been kind of a mask, you know. There's a lot of shit that it's not me, you know. I want people to see me a certain way just to gain respect, you know. And right now, even right now, I'm not going to be a hypocrite, you know. Maybe if I'm not a fucking champion and I'm fucking doing this for life, I wouldn't be scared to come out and say, I cry, you know?
Yeah.
I'm tough and I look good, you know? We're fucking muscular. We beat people up for a living. So we're allowed to say that we cry. We're allowed to say that we feel weak. Yeah. What about the other people, you know, the normal people that does the normal desk jobs? Are they allowed to say that, or they're going to be portrayed as weak, you know? It's just vulnerability and compassion. I think this is the most thing that I really like. I want to be remembered like that, man. It's not the career, it's the character. And this is what I want to be remembered. And really what hurt me is just, I remember something. It's just, there were a UFC fighter, Ryan Jimmo, you know, he was a great fighter. May he rest in peace. He was 30-1, and even know him right now when I tell you about it. Ryan Jim, he's 30-1. He passed away from a cardiac arrest, you know. So people aren't gonna remember us for how good we are as a fighters, you know. There's a lot of fighters that are gonna be bad, you know. People are not gonna remember John Jones when he's done. He's a fucking douchebag, you know. It's just what we do to the people around us and what kind of impact do we have on others. And maybe you don't know that, but you're not, I've always been scared to do Muay Thai, you know. Yeah. I know I'm a fucking good striker. I can put a lot of guys to sleep, but I've been scared to get exposed, man. What if I get knocked out? I lose the one thing that people talk about me as being the best striker coming out of Egypt, you know?
Yeah.
And then I see you, man, doing the BKB and doing the jiu-jitsu tournaments, and you're not afraid to put yourself out there, and this is a good impact on your side on me. Maybe you don't even know it. And I was like, fuck it, why don't I go for that? Even if I get fucking knocked out, who fucking cares, man? I'm doing this for me. I'm not doing this for people to judge me and say whether I'm the best, or who fucking cares who's the best? There's no such thing, man. It's just
happy. Yeah, be happy. And at the end of the day, you got to be happy with yourself. And like, that's what, like, when I lost that BKB fight, it was like, it hurt. It still fucking hurt. But a part of me, I think, I don't know if it's just with time, because this will be my 13th year, dude, doing martial arts and trying to be an MMA fighter. Like, I've been at this game a long time. And I can still count on my hand, on one hand, the times that I've lost. But, with every passing loss, it gets a little bit easier. And what I learned from that BKB fight was that I was finally willing. It took me 13 years to be willing to fight professionally in a striking art and put myself out there just to see what it would be like to get out of my comfort zone and how I did. And you know what? Even though I lost, I know I gained a lot more from it. I gained a lot of respect from the English boxing community. You know, I gained a lot of respect of you, you know, around the world. I got a flood of messages of people saying, bro, keep at it, keep doing it. You have a lot of potential. We all know you took that shit on a short notice. You should have no shame on what you did in there. And that gave me that, like what we were talking about, I made myself vulnerable. I took myself out of my shell. And I always think about, there's this book, bro. I highly recommend you read it. You would love it. It's called Josh Waitzkin's The Art of Learning. He's a black belt under Marcelo Garcia, but he was also a Tai Chi push hands master, won a bunch of tournaments. And then before that, he was known as being like a chess prodigy as a kid. And he talks about loss. and how he, when he, because he was like, dude, like everybody was saying, bro, this guy, this kid, he's like the motherfucking John Jones of chess, dude. Like this guy's playing six games of chess with the best guys in the, at the same time. And he got smashed in this tournament. And he says that like after that time, I took a lot of moments to reflect. My parents didn't put any pressure on me. And then he gives an example of this story of the you know what a hermit crab is? I don't know if you got them around you there. They're in the States, but it's like a hermit crab. It's like this little crab. They live in a shell, and they like crawl around. And then when you touch it, it'll hide in the shell, and it's all protected.
Yeah. I know what he's talking about.
So he says that this hermit crab, he's like, when you're trying to grow in whatever it is that you're trying to accomplish and you're trying to get to the next level, right? It's just like the hermit crab. Now the hermit crab is growing, it's growing inside this shell and it's become too big for the shell. So in order for it to get bigger and grow, it has to leave its shell and find another shell. And so now it can expand and become bigger and you know, grow and develop. But there's a brief moment that hermit crab has to escape his protective lair, what he is known to be his home, his safe place. And he has to be vulnerable to the world, to the exposures, to fish, to this and that. And in that vulnerability, the potential he might get killed, he might get eaten, he might get fucked up, he doesn't know. But in order for him to grow, he has to leave. And that's the vulnerability that when you do something like that, when you escape from your comfort spot and you go to the next shell, that is the only way you can grow. That is the only way. You have to be vulnerable. And you know what? You're gonna lose, you're gonna get hurt, you're gonna do that, but that's the only way we can grow. And that always, that every time when I'm like, when I was sitting back there and they were stitching up my face and I had a moment to myself, that story came in my head, you know.
That's beautiful. I would definitely read that. You know, I love that material, you know.
Yeah, it's a beautiful book, bro. I always, you know, especially for MMA guys, you know, why I wanted to do this podcast, not only for me to fucking rip and you to rip, but it's like you have people in Egypt that are all trying to come up in the MMA. You know, I got people from here that are asking me about training in Thailand that also want to do it, these younger guys. And I just want to give them knowledge that I wish somebody would have gave me, you know. And let's probably end this podcast. And like I said, like that's what I wanted to do, is I want these younger guys that either if they want to do MMA, boxing, whatever they want to do. I know martial arts is a hard journey. We just talked about how hard it can be, how hard failure can be. Like, dude, like if you had something to say to a younger guy and he's like, hey, Amr, man, like I don't know why this calls to me. I don't know why this is doing it. Like, what would you tell one of these guys, man? What would you give? What would be the best advice you could give them?
Well, man, it's just maybe not in the martial arts life in general. If somebody comes to me, like I have a lot of students back home and they're talking about martial arts and being the superstar. And I think everybody's wanted to do it for the wrong reasons. You know, they want to either get famous, which is get famous by what? And people think that we get paid a lot of money, which is fucking false. We're all fucking broke doing this. Lie to ourselves, man. If fucking Gary Tolman can close his gym because of Corona, you know, it's just, who am I to survive? You know, it's just,
yeah.
And I've been honest to people, and it's just, if you want to do it, it's just a journey, man. You don't think about the UFC. You don't think about the 1FC. You don't think about anything. You want to think of what are you gaining out of this journey? Why are you doing it? Are you doing it because of your angry, like I used to do it, like to channel your anger? There's 100 more ways, you know. Maybe you're not built for that sport. It's not a bad thing, you know, that you're not designed to take a punch in the face. You know, it's actually smart, you know. But if you're, it's what do you want to gain out of the journey, man? Either you're going to compete, either you're not going to compete. What kind of truth are you looking for? What kind of depth are you looking for? And I think I've talked about that before. It's just, I have one of my tattoos, this Horus, which is in ancient Egyptian, the god of war and truth.
Mm-hmm.
And he never had a single war in his, he was the god of war and he never went to war until one day his father got killed, which is Osiris, the god of tradition. And Set, which is the evil god, Horus went to war with Set, and he lost his eye in the war, and that's why his symbol is just one eye. And he came out of this war, you know, he took that one eye he lost and he passed to the underworld and he gave it to his father, you know. And the message out of that is just, it takes a lot to see what is in front of you, you know. And Osiris died because he didn't see what is in front of him. And Horus went to the underworld to give him his one eye just to see. And you have to see, you have to dig deep, man. You have to know what is inside of you. Why are you taking the next step? Why are you aiming at becoming a champion? You know, it's aiming and designing a future is a fucking illusion. We all know that by now, mm-hmm. you know. I aim to have 6 fights in this year, and I'm sitting on my ass right now.
Same, bro.
It's an illusion, man. But what is the bigger picture? It's like, what by the end of the year that is not fighting and making money and beating people? What do I want to become by the end of the year? I want to become healthier. I want to become happier. I want to become peaceful. And that's the bigger picture. It's the character. It's not the fighter. And I've had something written here that I'm gonna read it to. It's just, I've written it to one of my students that was going through a hard time, really going through a hard time. And he was, he left Egypt to become a mixed martial artist. He was doing well. And with the shutdown of all the gyms, he has a child and he didn't have any money. And we had to help him and shit. And,
yeah.
And I just wrote to him. It's just, dear, I'm just going to say you because I don't want to say the name. I told him, I need you to know that life will keep on flowing. People will always miss the big picture. They will be so caught up in tomorrow that they don't know it's not going to matter in a week. In fact, in a week, they will have a new tomorrow to worry about. Dear you, I need you to know that blood runs like ink and heart beats are music. You're gonna fail and you're gonna listen to your heart one day. Your world is so new and you're still young. So much sky to fly above and so much deep water to explore. Dear you, I need you to know that most people are evil. You have your share of that. If they change for the better, it's for themselves. If they change for the worse, it's also for themselves. Dear you, please know that you're gonna die. That's not a lie. But your life is an orchestra, a sad music. But don't forget how sad music can be so beautiful. As I leave you to yourself to reflect upon what happened to you, maybe watch some stupid Netflix movie, I need you to know that your ink, your ideas, is in your blood. That your heart will always speak music. That people are mostly evil, but the world is a beautiful adventure. You are emotional, but your emotions are art, and art is emotions. Please embrace what you have with open arms, and you will have everything you want in this life.
Wow, man.
Yeah. And I think that's a good way to end it.
Oh yeah, dude. Fuck it. You almost made me tear up, bro. Fuck. Just a little bit. A little bit, man. Well, dude, thanks again, bro. Like, bro, this ended up being a really good talk, man. Like,
one of the best, man. Yeah, I miss our pumping days. People would know what pumping is. It's not a fucking go-go bar.
Yeah.
Okay. It's a legit place where we sit down and have a meal and talk. I miss those days. And
yeah, me too, man.
Inshallah, they'll come back so soon, man, and we'll have you back here, inshallah, so soon.
Yeah, dude, I'm missing my Thailand family, bro, and you know, I had a really great time training with the guys at Team Quest, and you know, it's a good group of guys we had there, you know, and you know, I was going through a lot when I came up to Chiang Mai, and I mean, I know I didn't say what was going on in my own personal life, but you guys definitely did help me out a lot, and help make me a champion. So
you're a great guy, man. And you're a champion in material without even holding that sword. So it's been an honor really training the side with you, man.
And same to you, bro. Same to you. So before we leave, bro, if you got any plugs, if anybody wants to get in contact with you, wants to train with you, wants to just follow your fight career, how can they find you, man?
Yeah, Instagram, man. I'm always on that shit. 24/7, my eyes on in my phone. There's no escaping social media. So no. I'm always on Instagram, man. So if you want to just hit me up, I reply to all the messages.
Right on, bro.
I don't pick and choose, you know.
Sick, sick. All right, cool, man. Well, thanks again, dude. I'll end the recording, bro. And yeah, man, thanks again. This is some good stuff, bro. It was good.
Thank you so much, man.
Yeah.